Here we go.
Good morning.
Good afternoon.
Good evening,
wherever you are.
Around the world with Idiotic.
What movie was that from?
Yeah, I don't know. Good morning, Idiotic! My quasi Robin Williams there. Oh my goodness.
You sounded just like him.
Yeah, totally.
There's a career for you somewhere out there.
Yeah. I've got a face for radio, as they say.
And here you're doing crowdcast.
Yeah, here we do. Here we go. Oh, good morning, gang. How's everybody doing?
Well, I'm good. It's only six degrees in Arizona, so yeah,
it's only minus 23 in Ontario.
Yeah, we've got six here in the Netherlands as well, so Brent and I are totally aligned.
It's a beautiful day.
Very good. Very, very good. Folks, we have Jeff Kortenbosch with us here today. Jeff, give you a minute here to introduce yourself. Tell folks about yourself.
Well, I'm Jeff. I'm in L&D for almost 20 years. Started out back then as an e-learning designer, rolled into more performance consulting, got a background in IT from even when I was younger and still had my hair. So I'm doing learning technology stuff as well. And really focused on, doing the stuff that matters these days. So understanding the problem, knowing what the real results should look like, and seeing what we can do to make that happen.
Very cool. Awesome. And you're joining us from the Netherlands. I don't know if we've actually said that out loud yet today. So we're global today.
It's a
global episode. You know.
Idiotic goes international.
That's right. We're outside of the North American comfort zone. I don't know. Today we're talking about questions to ask before talking about training. So many of us talk about how we're in this place where, oh, somebody comes to us and here, we need a course on this. Oh, and we've already got these slides or here's a product manual. We got to cover it all. And many of us don't feel empowered to do much about that, you know, the corporate culture or even people not understanding what we think our role should be, et cetera. And I'm hoping that some of these questions that we're going to give people today will help them in that kind of situation.
Yeah, I'm absolutely sure they will. I've been applying them for several years now. Started sharing what I do a couple of years ago on conferences, and then people told me, "Jeff, you need to write a book about this." And I said, "I don't know, writing books, and this is not rocket science." But the more people telling me that, "Hey, this is stuff that really works," I actually wrote a little book about it. So
very cool.
And it got a great reception, and I'm really looking forward to talking with you guys about these questions and everybody on the call just being able to take a look, start using them, and be an even better rock star than you are already.
Mm-hmm. So do we need any more, do we need to establish a scenario here before we start talking about the questions?
Like
a bit of context?
I don't know. For me, it started out, like I said, I started out as an e-learning designer back in the day. When people came into my office saying, "Hey, Jeff, we need e-learning," I said, "Oh, cool. That's what I do. All right. Come on, sit down. What do you want to talk about? What topics need to go in there?" We built a really pretty e-learning and got all the check marks in the LMS and, a whopping 30% of people did it. That's where it started. And at some point you see stuff going wrong in your projects and then you see them happening again and you think, "Hey, okay, wait a second. How does that happen? What don't I know?" And then all these things came bubbling up, and I'm kind of lazy. I have a YouTube channel with tutorials. which is actually for me, because I don't remember that stuff all the time. So I just create a tutorial myself, and then it's out there for the world, and I know where to find it. So I created this kind of cheat list for myself with the questions that I want to ask. And it kind of got longer, and they changed. And it's a fairly organic list, but it's kind of been pretty much the same for the last couple of years. And I was always trying to just, in the conversation, just remember this thing. And I've got at some point I had my laptop on the side trying to make notes. And at some point I just sat down with a guy, said, I'm going to make notes of this meeting and I'm going to share them with you. And let's put that on the screen. Right. And we were sitting there and all of a sudden this co-creation vibe started. And this guy was, you know, he was taking ownership, and I was asking him these questions, writing it down, and said, am I saying this in the right way? Is this what you're saying? Yeah. So at the end, we had this really good document where he said, wow, I can take this to my boss and talk about the budget and the need we have and how we've described it. I didn't have this before. So that was just a beautiful way of me kind of stumbling into a sort of workshop around a needs analysis that turns into a sort of a business case for the client you're talking to, whether it be external or internal. So that's kind of where it all started.
Mm-hmm. If you have one go-to question, is there one question, you know, where you always start with, or do you have a batch of questions that you pick from?
No, so it's 20 questions, and I kind of go through the list. Mm-hmm. And the order feels right. Okay. I've shifted around a couple of times in the earlier parts, but I go through them in order. So obviously I start first with what's the problem, right? Because I want to hear from them what the problem is. Not, and I know they want training from me because they knocked on the L&D door. But I really want to know what is the problem that you think you need training for. So, and all these 20 questions are just set up questions for more questions, of course. So can you tell me a little bit more about that? So why is that? And then you can get a good picture of what the problem is, and then is there a business reason for this? Because we always want to have a business reason for stuff, and a lot of the people that will knock on your L&D door will not have a real business reason attached with it. It's not part of the strategy. It's just something they came up with, right? Yes, they have a problem, but I might not be the one to solve it for you. If we're looking at all the other stuff that's on our desks and questions coming in, because we need to prioritize. Now, one of the questions I find is really important is the one where we talk about, do you have a solution in mind already? And of course they do. Of course they do, right? But it gives them time to talk about it. And we can write it down, and we can have a short discussion about, yeah, that could be possible. And then I can safely move on from that and explore the problem and a possible solution further. So for us L&D people, I call that the parking lot question, right? So I can just have a conversation with them. They feel you're building this trust, and yes, he's listening to me, and they're hearing me out about my training plans that I want to. Cool. Yeah. Cool. Okay. Let's put that aside. Let's take a look at the problem a little bit more. Then what does success look like? You know, if you close your eyes, magic has happened a year from now, or maybe if you're in agile organization, several weeks from now, what's different and how can we tell? Right. And that's the question. That's the question I love the most. What does success look like?
Yeah.
Where people fall silent.
And how can we tell? Like adding that little bit on the end there, I think is really critical, right? I don't know if you use that as a separate question, like that's the second question, or if it is all one question, but that's a
specific measurement question. So how can we measure with means that we have? Mm-hmm. But this is part of it, right? So what does it look like and how can we tell? Because is there a different behavior? Is the organization structure different? What's different, right? Those are the things that I'm after. And if they cannot tell, and usually they're having a hard time telling what success looks like. And it's often this aha moment. I remember I worked for a large retailer, which has meatballs and bookcases. And I was in Sweden. And they have this design philosophy, and they said, "Well, we've got huge turnovers in our design product design teams, and we're not meeting all our targets on our design philosophy." And they had these like encyclopedias of stories around that philosophy, and said, you can take it in a play and turn it into a really great course, so our product teams will be better. I said, well, I shoved it back over the table towards them. I said, well, actually, I'm not going to read all this. I would like to know a little bit more about what you think success looks like and what's going wrong now. What does good look like? And they were sitting there. But we don't know. So are there people in your product teams that know that are really good? Yes, we think so. Well, maybe we should have a conversation with them and see what's right and what's wrong. And And at the end of the meeting, they thought, we need to go back to the drawing board and we need to talk to our teams, to our people. Yes, let's go do that. And that's brilliant.
Yeah, if you can get them to do that, like getting them to think more deeply than, hey, you're just the training team. You just make e-learning, right? Just go ahead and make some e-learning on this. That's what you do, right? Why are you asking me so many questions? You know?
But it's really about, give me some time to understand what you're dealing with. And I think this is where we are often too much service-oriented. I know I was, you know, I wanted to help, wanted to do a good job. I wanted to show that to my bosses that, you know, look, I'm doing all this work here and they're loving it. But that's not what makes a difference. You know, I think training is never the answer or the solution to a problem. It can be part of it. It can be a really good part of it if we do our jobs well, but just stuffing training down people's throats in what form, that won't make a big change in the organization. So it's really about figuring out what all the other parts are, and how training fits into that.
Yeah. So it's interesting because, I think to your point earlier, when people were asking you, hey, you should write a book about this, it does seem kind of simple, right? And when you see the questions and when you look at it, you're like, oh yeah, I ask those. But in my mind, when I go back, I've been doing this for a long time too. And it's like, I know I don't do a good job at asking those questions, and I like and appreciate you sharing them in that order, and it helps me to know that they're there and to know that I want to get through all of them. Because if you just kind of wing it, a lot of times you think you know the answer to some of those questions, and so you don't even ask, and so you skip a lot of the steps, right?
It's the assumptions, right?
Yeah.
I was working at the Dutch Railway last year, and their projects were like, you know, they were working really hard, but they had nothing documented on what's the outcome, what's the effect, and at some point I asked, don't we have like an intake process? Oh yeah, we've got a brilliant intake process. Oh, cool. Nobody told me. I'm here for 2 months, right? So what does it look like? Oh, let me dig that up. And I saw it and think, wow, it's like 80% of the questions I ask. So what's happening? Oh, we don't use this. Because we kind of know these things because we're working here for a long time already. So we know what most of these questions. So we just grab a few. Okay, so what if we just started using this? And document it all down together with our internal client and really make sure that, you know, we know what we need to do. Yeah. You know, I was talking to Citibank. I was invited to talk to their L&D specialist a couple months ago about the same topic. And now, do you have an intake process? Silence. Right? Yes, no, not really. For me, it's just a great activity, and I can structure it. I've got the questions, and we're forcing ourselves go through this. So this is, let's say, I don't plan for a 1 hour intake meeting. I plan for a 2 hour intake workshop. If they don't have 2 hours for me, then I probably don't want to have that project at all.
You know, there's a great question in the chat added, and I don't know if this is one of your questions, and we just haven't gotten to it yet, but asking about, have you tried to solve this problem before?
Yes. So one of the things, of what have you done already? What has and hasn't worked? Why not? It's one of the obvious questions, but if you add the why hasn't it worked to it, and how can you prove that to me? What does the data say, or why do you know it doesn't work? Is one of those questions. But similar to, can I talk to some people who are experiencing this problem? Now, for many, many years in my career, the people that were telling me, hey, we need training, and if I asked them, can I talk to anyone in the business? They said, you don't need to. We know the problem. But it's when you go down there and you talk to people and say, okay, what's happening here? And then you see their real environment, right? I remember... I was working it was at IKEA, and we were having this program developed for forklift truck drivers, and they said, well, okay, it's performance support and it's e-learning and it's a combination of these things. I said, oh cool, so performance support, how are they accessing that? So, well, they have to go to a computer because they work in the warehouse. So okay, let's go down to the warehouse, right? So we went down to the warehouse, we saw the forklift, and there was a monitor on the forklift truck. Okay, what does that thing do? So, this is where they see all the orders they need to, but is that connected to the network somehow? Yeah. So can we add something there? And we started pressing some buttons, and then Internet Explorer opened. And voila, several weeks later, they had performance support running on the forklift truck. So. Nice. Get to the floor, see what's happening there, right? I've been a consultant for a very short stint, was not my thing, but I was in this insurance company, and the client told us he wanted this big 3D virtual mountain to explain DevOps to their IT people. And okay, and we sold an analysis phase there. So we went down, talked to the people, did the personas, design thinking sessions, all that magic. And what they really wanted was this performance support environment. And they had kind of this wiki platform already in place. Hey, we've got something we can use. And we came up with a concept for that. And the user said, this is what really will help us. So we presented that. And then we got invited to the head office, yelled at and kicked out because it wasn't a virtual 3D mountain. But the analysis was good.
Well, that's, you know what, that's what I was gonna say. I mean, there's a lot of times in what we do there, they may even really appreciate the fact that you go through the analysis with them and you've given them a different, cheaper solution. But sometimes, yeah, it is just, we happen to have a lot of extra money that we need to spend, and we'd like a 3D mountain.
Yeah, you know, sometimes you got people that want prestige projects. That's great. I think prestige comes from the impact that you make. I did a project at IKEA where if we would increase sales by 10%, then we would get 400 million euros a year extra, right? And that was a reasonable thing to make happen. And we built this hybrid performance tool where there was some support in there, but it was all about how do I help people to do their jobs more easy. I got called to the governance board, said, Jeff, this is not really a learning solution. I said, I know, there's learning inside of it though. And it's making us 400 million a year, right? So it all depends. So I think that's sexy.
Mm-hmm. I mean, Mr. J's making a note. It sounds like similar to what you're just describing. But in the past, I was met with, give me what I want or I won't own the outcomes, which is never what you want, from your stakeholder. But what strikes me is that, like when we started out here, you were talking about, Buddy is knocking on the L&D door and asking, yeah. and you're just exploring some questions about the whole thing. I mean, we have a formal step in most of our processes called needs analysis. And if we trot out the steps of an, you know, and people go, whoa, 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 we don't need all that process. We already know everything that we need. We're telling you we need a course here. But the approach of just starting it out with questions turns it into a conversation.
Yeah.
Turns it into an opportunity for people to reframe without feeling threatened to a certain degree, right? People have already got this vision of the 3D mountain environment, in their mind. And that's what they've already done a group think. There's several of them that think this is a brilliant idea, and they've now got their, their reputations, their structure, their alpha beta status in the pack of that group think or whatever, it's all invested in that. An approach without calling it needs analysis, just calling it some questions. Let's talk about this. Let me ask you some questions. Turns it into something that produces results, but I think also offers an opportunity to alter perspectives in a kind of gentler fashion than telling somebody that they're wrong and dumb.
You're not going in there saying, I won't build you your course. You're going in there, I want to understand what you're dealing with, and I want to understand what we're working towards, and see how we can help. And just going through the process with them, like I said, most of the time there are these aha moments where they think, oh my God, I hadn't thought about that, or I need to think about that, and you're just helping them along the process, right? And it's us as professionals, if we kind of set ourselves up to be that professional partner for them, and they feel helped, that's where you want to be, right? Mm-hmm. Then there's the trust. And then there's also, we've tried this and this in the past, and that might be really interesting for this project here, or I've got some ideas, and bear with me, right? And just take them along that journey. But it starts with building that trust and working on that document together already creates something. There's some magic there, because you're putting that together, you're putting the words together, and they are seeing this thing come alive that just strengthens their thinking and their mission and their the reason why they're sitting down with you.
Yeah, it reminds me a lot of, and not to get too meta here, but I've read books on influence, and I'm sure everybody's read the seminal book, Getting to Yes, and books like that, right? And being influential and trying to get people to, accept your ideas and what you're thinking. And it always comes back to what asking questions does for you. It gives them an opportunity, it does a lot of things, but it gives them the opportunity to have that aha moment, right?
Yeah.
So instead of there being a battle of wills where they have an idea of what should happen, you have an idea of what should happen, and you just start to battle about it. It's more like you're asking a lot of questions, giving them the opportunity to think, giving them the opportunity to come up with new ideas. And maybe the solution isn't exactly what you intended at the beginning, but you more comfortably, to Chris's point, you more comfortably and gently meet in the middle and say, hey, yes, this is a new hybrid solution that's going to make you happy. It's going to make me happy. I feel like we're going to be able to solve the problem. Yeah. You're going to get what you want, and you can make all that happen.
And it's not about us, right? I was in a session at the bank where I work now, and they were saying, oh, we're doing this great training for this really important thing, and it's just great training. But, when people get back to work, they're not really applying it, and they're not doing it, they're not making the change. So we need to have something that happens after after that really great training. I said, so is the training great for you, or is it great for the people? Because first thing you said, after the training, they don't apply what we've what we've pulled them through for the past X days. So how is that great training then, right? So do you get nice reviews, or all the content is in there, or how is that great training? And they started thinking, yeah, you got a really good point there. We're looking at it from our perspective, not from the people who actually need to go back to work and hopefully do what we want them to do.
Mm-hmm. Mr. J asked in the chat, you know, what's the question that gets the most light bulb moment most frequently? Is there a particular question that you're kind of sitting there going, okay, here it is, roll it out, and
there are a couple. The success question is really a good one, where because then they realize I really don't know what that looks like. I've got this question where I look at, so what besides skills and knowledge, what else is involved here? So is it motivation? Is it organizational barriers? You know, and I usually help them draw up this quadrant where I put that down and say, okay, with this problem in mind or this change in mind, write down on post-its, right? Where are the issues? And then in the top, you see skills and knowledge, and there are always a few post-its there. And there's usually tons of post-its in motivation and even more in organizational barriers, saying, okay, so if we just focus on skills and knowledge, we're kind of missing out on a lot here. Are there, so that gives them an insight saying, ooh, wow, we've got all these processes and procedures and maybe managers that are having trouble leading the way we need to be led. You know, they gain these insights just from that simple activity. So that's always a nice aha moment.
Mm-hmm. Kim W in the chat had a similar, she said, during a focus group with business leaders, they were telling my team about the training they wanted. I asked if there was anything besides training that was a barrier to performance. They said, oh yes. And she's got that in all caps. Oh yes.
but
you're asking, and then people are cracking the walnut open and you're getting to the meat of things then.
The moment you create an activity for them to work on, they're not going to sit there and say, I'm not going to do this. If they do, that's another interesting thing. It hasn't happened to me in the years that I've been doing this, but it's a really easy activity. Yeah? Just running the post-its and, you know, some people say, oh, just let's take like 10, 15 minutes to do this. And sometimes they're still writing and writing and writing. You need 10 minutes more. We're going to get a coffee. Go up with your post-its, right? Those are the things that give the aha moments. I've got a question about what resources are and budget do you have available for implementation? Mm. Now, and this is where, you know, I think in L&D, we often mess up at the front and at the end of things. In the middle, we create something. But if we do that needs analysis, that intake really well, and we already start discussing about how can we reach the people that this is for? What do we need for that? And what are our targets, right? Well, what do we want to see in the first month? What do we see in the first 3 months? What do we want to see in a year? And what are we going to do if we're not seeing the numbers that we're after? What is plan B? in all my years that I've been doing this, we usually said, okay, we've created the training. It's out there. We're doing the communication thing to it, so a banner on the LMS where nobody comes anyway, and the intranet, which is the first page that starts up when you open your browser, which is like the ultimate blind spot. You know, that's not an implementation plan, right? But most organizations do it like that. You know, I don't know anyone in the chat recognize that, but you need to really take the time to think about how are we going to reach the people?
Yeah. We got a question in the ask a question section too. And I like this one from Pat. It says, so the list of questions, is it a simple Word document or a fancy form that you share with them, the stakeholders or whatnot, and, or somewhere in between? This document is something that you work through together virtually?
It's a Word document, so you can do it. You can do it live. You can do it online. Share screen. It's just a question with a nice gray table, one cell table below it, so I can type into a box that looks where that needs to be typed in, and it feels good. Like you see, fill it up, and it just, you know, if I've got a long piece of text, it just slides down. So it's like the simplest way to do this. If you download my book, there's a form, a Word document comes with that. It has some 20 questions branding, but you can kick all that out and just make it look like put your logo in the top, and then voila, it's yours. I've done it at IKEA now, at the Dutch Railway, and at the bank where I work. Okay, let's take a look at the, oh, we don't have intake. Oh, cool. Change font to corporate font, add logo in the top. Oh, wow, this is a document we have. Yes, we have. So it's reformatted. It's a Word document. And if I want to create a workshop where people stand around a room, I can create a quick PowerPoint out of it, right? And just print it on A3 and just hang it around and just go through it and have them do it. So it is that simple.
Yeah. Have you ever had to go back to it and say, like, did things kind of go off the rails, and have you had to go back to it and say, okay, remember when we had this conversation and you filled this out, this is what you said, you know? And
good question. It is a great way of contracting as well. So not only are you helping them with their needs analysis, with their business case, it's also something you can pull back to. So one of the last question actually is there anything I haven't asked yet that I need to know that's important? Hmm. Right, I've been in projects where even in company where we had a supplier come in, talk about the problem, the possible solutions, and when they left, I was walking back to our offices with the business stakeholder saying, "Oh, this is going so wrong. They didn't ask about this. They didn't ask about this. And why didn't you tell them? Well, they didn't ask." But how are they ever going to come up with a good proposal if you're leaving all this super important information out? So this is the question that you just have to ask. Is there anything I need to know that you haven't told me yet? and this is often where you come back, right? So, hey, remember when we talked, this is a new thing, right? What you're bringing up here. And I asked, right, is there anything I need to know? And you tell me no, or just these and these things. So it really helps for contracting as well.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Jay Zeiding, I found it goes better as a conversation rather than sharing the document with the requester.
Oh, yes.
Sharing it with them could put them on the defense, whereas the conversation usually builds the trust that Jeff is discussing. Yeah, so it's not a thing that you're going to say, here, fill this in, and then send it back to me. You're facilitating it. We're not
forwarding it. They're usually seeing the questions for the first time when we're together. If I get a feeling that, you know, these people need to put in some real research to figure out what's going on, so it depends on the complexity of it, you might want to say, okay, we're going to do a workshop, and these are the things we're going through. So have a think about that, and don't send me anything. Don't fill in this form, because then I probably won't. You send them the form, then I will probably just send them the questions or the most important ones. So I would never just send out the form, say, oh, just fill this in and then we'll talk about that. No, it's about the conversation that's going on, the questions you can ask while they are thinking about. And it really helps seeing them struggling with the answer. Because then, you know, there's something there that you need to dig a little deeper.
Mm-hmm.
We've got about 10 minutes or so left to talk through some of this stuff. And first of all, Jeff, before I forget, drop your link into that book, into the chats. People are already asking. I was going to wait until the end, but go ahead and drop in your stuff now. It's okay to do that.
Yes.
So people can find it in case they have to bug out early or whatnot. But this is a great question. I had not thought of talking about this in around this topic, but Cheryl asks about, and I'm going to kind of paraphrase for you, Cheryl. But soft skills stuff. I'll read her question so to kind of frame this a little bit, but it got me thinking about soft skills. She says, what questions would you ask if designing a training series for doctorate participants if it were to explain a company's stance and employee expectations on topics like racism, gender, inclusion, sexual orientation, etc.? Or how would you frame 2 to 3 of these 20 questions? And so it just got me thinking about, how does this work for soft skills stuff? Is it the same?
In a way, yes. You might have some more vague measurements. I don't need rocket science here, right? If I'm looking for what does the result look like, but you know, these questions come from somewhere. So they have a problem and they have an idea of what success should look like, or maybe not. But then that's a good way to trigger them. And then it's about, so what can we do? And often with these things, there is much more than just training, right? The topics you brought up, there's communications, there's marketing, a lot of stuff that happens in L&D, and especially on the digital side of it, is more of a communication problem, where they build some training, where they say, oh, wait a second, what you're talking about, that's like marketing here. You need to weave the story about what kind of organization we want to be, what's happening, what we don't want happening. So so that's where you start realizing that you need to have multiple solutions to one end, right? So I think yes, these questions are very relevant, even if it's about soft skills.
It's got to be hard, because I think people struggle with what's that outcome, right? If we go back to that question, that's a really important one, right? What do we want to see different when they get out of this training? It's really hard to change human behavior just right after somebody has consumed some media of some sort, right?
Yeah.
And it's hard sometimes to actually be able to see and measure a change in something that's cultural or OD like, or organizational development like, right? Or in interpersonal, or as Mr. J would say, professional skills. You know, those types
people skills. I see from Cassie. But it starts with you're seeing something that you don't want to see, right? And you want to change that. So this is where change management comes in, and it's not just a training problem. So, but you know, knowing what the real problem is, finding out if it's local, or it's something that goes through your entire company, you know, these questions will get you there. So is this deeply ingrained in our culture, or do we have some location that needs special attention? I work at a bank now, and we have stores where people come in and buy bank products, right? They get helped. And some stores are better than other stores. So do I roll out one big program for all stores to be better at selling mortgages, because that's one of the key targets? Or do I look at, hey, who's on target, who's over target, and who's off target, and see what's happening there? And try to figure out, so why are the people that are on target or over target doing so incredibly well, but then focus on where the problem is. Does this answer the question?
I think so. Yeah. Go ahead, Chris.
Yeah. Well, Taisha is asking in the chat, my work culture doesn't support doing this analysis on every project. How do you determine which projects to push to use the full process on?
I think that the starter questions, you know, the first questions on the list are really great to determine how far you need to take this. At the Dutch Railroad where I worked, we broke it up in two sessions. So the product owner, they were doing agile, could do this smaller intake and then get a feel for what that was like. If they know what the problem is, if you see, is this something that needs to get fixed quickly, or is it something really big and it needs more attention, and then pull in the L&D specialist that does the further analysis and the question session. So I would break that up then to see, is this a big thing, a little thing, complex or simple, or that's how I would do it.
I'll add to that just sort of an extension of that question, because I was thinking the same thing. Since you're not doing this on a contract basis, you mentioned, you know, this works great for contracting. That's kind of what I was thinking it would work best at, actually. Do you find yourself, since you're in a permanent position doing this, that all the different groups, once you've been there for a while, they start to kind of know ahead of time, so you start needing it less and less and less? Or do you find yourself still going through the full process?
It depends on who the people are you're talking to. If that changes all the time, then it's a new process for them every time. If you're talking to the same group every time, so if you look at the intake process, then I like to see or figure out who are allowed to ask us questions. Now, is every person from the organization doing that? Because that is like a strain on my resources, right? But if we have this group of business people that the organization can go to saying, hey, we've got this problem, and you can help them set up this process, go through and create that business case. That's then where you see you're giving them the process to take that back to their people that ask them the questions before they come to us. And then you get to a different level of maturity, of course.
Mm-hmm. And some of these questions too, depending on your connection, even in terms of physical space, but some of these are almost things that you can drop in casually, in a more conversational way rather than a formal, here's the Word doc that we're going to work through. And then mm-hmm. using that to measure a reaction.
Definitely.
Sorry, let me just jump in here real quick, because I did miss part of one of those questions, and Cheryl's dropping it in again in the chat for CPUs, LinkedIn style courses, those like type of sort of generic topic type training that sometimes we all get asked to make at one point or another. How do you approach that kind of stuff?
Well, I think there are things that you like have to do, right? My wife's a nurse. She needs to do training for points as well to stay accredited. And in the bank, you have to do. I had to do stuff in the bank where I'm never talking to clients. but I had to go through them because I work at a bank. I think there are It doesn't have to be all the traditional stuff where people go, oh my God, I have to go through all this. But maybe in some cases, depending on the culture, these are the compliance must-haves, and this is the way we measure it, right? It would be great if you can get to that level at legal, at compliance, saying, hey, you've always been doing it like this. Are there other ways to do this, to measure it as well? There's how can we do that in a smart way? But it is a tricky one. Yes, because I see my wife doing completely random courses, which I never do this at work, but I get points for it, and I have to do it. It is a tricky thing there. Yeah, but you can, if the organization is open to it, you can make that a better user experience and make it more meaningful and more relevant.
I'll also send Cheryl and anybody else that's interested to our conversation with Dr. David Merrill. He had some good points around this kind of stuff. We don't have enough time really to go into it today. We need to wrap things up here, but go back to that show and you guys can listen on that. It's great. I mean, if you've never heard Dr. Merrill or read any of his books or anything, it's a great introduction to him as a person. He talks about some of this stuff too from that side, and the professional skills and how we go through that stuff as well. So not to take away from this, but just to give people some extra resources,
I just tossed the link for that episode into the chat there, so if anybody's interested in that, they can take a peek at that in the blog format that that Brent put up as a wrap up on that, but the video is embedded right there.
I see Donna is saying, right, so we are required to generate compliance training. So there are things you can win and things you cannot win, right? Sometimes, not every project. I can tell you about all the amazing projects that I've done. Next to those amazing projects, there are like 8 shitty ones where I thought, if I would have never done that in my life, then I would be perfectly happy. So you need to take what you can take there and be pragmatic. And the more good examples you can show, hey, we did this last time in a different way, and this is the result. Would you like to have that result as well? Mm-hmm. Ooh, yes. So build up to that. Just start, have your story straight, have you work through it. And if you're working in a team, do the same thing, right? It's not that, I'm going to go with Chris because he's not asking me these difficult questions that Brent's asking me, right? So be consistent in that way and set your foot down. We are the L&E professionals. We know our jobs. They don't. But we need to help them get through that. And they need to see us be there to help them beyond just bouncing and training their way.
Very cool. Yeah. It's a common theme in a lot of our episodes, is getting past that order taking and how do you struggle with that. And the 20 questions, if folks haven't seen the link yet, Jeff, maybe toss it back into the chat.
boom.
and any contact info if people want to find you on LinkedIn or anything like that, that's awesome to add in.
Yes.
And, oh, there's the new music. Let's dance on out of here, gang.
Yeah, what
thank
a great
you so
way
much,
to wrap
guys.
Up.
Thank you, everyone that was here today.
Yeah, thanks for joining us, Jeff. And thanks to everybody for the great questions and the great thoughts in the chat. Always awesome participation. And we'll see you all next week.
Yes, indeed. Fantastic. And also, if you have not been invited to the idiotic group on LinkedIn, just to kind of toss that in, we've got a group now for all of you idiotic folks out there in the chat. Join us there. If you haven't been invited or haven't found it, get out there and do that. And I will second all of the thank yous, Jeff. Thank you so much. It's always fun to talk with you. Thanks for coming on.
Thank you so much, guys. I need a refill.
Yeah.
No.